One of the cool things about chord function is that we can use special sets of chords at the ends of phrases and get different types of cadences that are recognizable orally as well as in written form. Here's the overview, the basic types that we have. We have authentic, plagal, half, and deceptive. Authentic basically means you have a dominant to tonic. It's kind of the standard conclusive cadence. Plagal means instead of going 5-1, we go 4-1. Half is an open cadence where we end on a 5 chord. And deceptive is when we end with a chord other than tonic, substituting for tonic, that can surprise or deceive us. Now, all of that is well and good. But you're probably wondering, well, what does this sound like? What does this even mean? Well, I have some examples for you. Here are the properties of a perfect authentic cadence. They're pretty strict. You have a root position 5 chord, or it could be a 5-7 chord, which goes to tonic, which also must be in root position. So root position 5 to root position 1. That means your bass is going to be sol, do. And not only do those things have to be true, but then when you get to the one chord, your melody or top line also needs to end on do. It creates a really conclusive kind of final sort of sound. We're going to look at an excerpt from a piano piece titled Mother's Sacrifice, written by composer L. Viola Kinney. She's from Missouri, my home state, and she lived in the first half of the 20th century. This piece, Mother's Sacrifice, is the only surviving work of hers. So we're looking at the part starting in measure 50. Notice the key signature there is 2 flats. Our key choices would be B flat major or G minor. This passage happens to be in G minor. Do you notice that the first chord there is a G minor chord? That can sometimes be a giveaway to help you figure out what the key is in. So I'm not going to do a harmonic analysis of this entire piece, but I want to focus on the cadence. And the cadence happens here. We get a 5 chord to a 1. The bass note is D or sol of the 5, and that goes to do of the 1, G. And then look at the melody line, the soprano. It also ends on do. Therefore, this cadence is a perfect authentic cadence. We abbreviate perfect authentic cadence with the letters PAC or PAC. Let's listen to this beautiful passage. Indeed, a very conclusive sounding cadence. That was performed by pianist Maria Corley. Our next example will demonstrate the imperfect authentic cadence. Imperfect authentic cadences also are conclusive. They go from a dominant functioning chord, either 5 or the 7, which also functions dominantly, to tonic. If it's a 5 chord, it could be inverted, or the 1 chord could be inverted. If it's a 7 chord, you don't need to worry about position. If either the 5 or the 1 are inverted, meaning the root's not the lowest note, or the melody ends on a scale degree that's not tonic, not do, you can get an imperfect authentic cadence. So there's a lot of different ways we can get imperfect authentic cadences. The example of the imperfect authentic cadence I want to share with you is written by composer Florence Price. This is a song called Night. Florence Price was an American composer born in Arkansas in 1887 and died in Chicago in 1953. Her claim to fame was that she was the first Black American woman to win widespread recognition as a composer of symphonies, and she rose to prominence in the 1930s. She's also the first Black American woman to have an orchestral work performed by a major American orchestra. So, as we look at the score of the Florence Price example, we look at the very last two chords that are being used, and that will form the imperfect authentic cadence. Thinking in the key of C major, the key of the piece, the notes I've highlighted in yellow form the G7 chord, or the 5-7 in the key of C. This chord is in root position. And the notes I've highlighted in pink form the tonic triad, the C major chord in the key of C, also in root position. So you might be thinking, gosh, Victoria, these are two root position chords, dominant going to tonic. Wouldn't this be a perfect authentic cadence? Oh, my friends, but no, because of this note. The top note we hear is not tonic, it is not do, but rather scale degree 3, or mi. Because we do not have the top melody ending on do, this has to be an imperfect authentic cadence. So we label it with IAC or IAC for the imperfect authentic cadence. Let's listen to this beautiful example. That was Icy Renee Simpson singing. The next example I want to share with you features the plagal cadence. Plagal cadences are easy to identify because they're simply the four chord going to the one chord. They still sound pretty conclusive because they end on tonic. Tonic is our chord of repose. It's kind of like a home base. But the four doesn't quite have the same sort of pull to tonic as the five chord does. And that difference is marked enough that we have a different cadence label for it, and we call it plagal. The example I want to share of this with you is a song performed by Paul Simon called A Church is Burning. What we're going to hear is an E flat major chord go to a B flat major, 5. And then we're going to hear that go to 4, A flat major, and then back to E flat tonic for the plagal motion. This is at the very beginning of the track.
A church is burning. The flames rise high.
The next type of cadence we're taking a look at is the deceptive cadence. That's the kind of cadence when we have a five chord and we would expect to go to a one, but we get a chord that substitutes for one. That's something different than one. The prototypical kind of deceptive cadence is when it goes to a six chord. This is how it looks and sounds in a major key. And in minor. And the example I have to share with you is from the band Styx. And this is their song called The Best of Times. What I want you to do is about 19 seconds into this example, I want you to listen for the words hands of time. And the chord that is used when they sing time is the sixth chord that is substituting for tonic and constitutes the deceptive cadence. Let's listen. Not everyone's cup of tea. So I have one more deceptive cadence example for you. This example comes from Mozart. And what's interesting about this example is that the chord that substitutes for tonic in this deceptive cadence is not the sixth chord as it's typically used, but instead a really interesting and exciting chromatic chord here. This piece is the Kyrie movement from his Requiem, which is a mass for the dead. And he wrote this at the very end of his life. It was one of his last works. And just to show you how the chords work, I know this score is a little complicated looking because we have a lot of parts, but we're in D minor. Notice we have a five chord here. And then we get this chromatic chord built on G sharp. By the way, this is a fully diminished seventh chord, and it's pretty cool. And then by the time we get to the end of the piece, the movement, we actually do get an authentic cadence. So here we get our authentic cadence. I'm going to go ahead and call it a pack, just because in the soprano part, we get do. And then here, I'm gonna label this as our deceptive cadence. Now I'll play the example. And I have one more example to share with you. This is a recording by the Beatles, and it's the very end of their song For No One. And this is the end of the song. And the half cadence is an interesting use here because it's our least conclusive kind of cadence. It leaves us hanging. Basically, a half cadence happens whenever you end on the five chord. It's ending on dominant function. It's like a question mark. Let's listen to the end of For No One. I hope those examples got you a little bit excited about different cadence types. They really do create shape and harmonic meaning in the music we like to listen to.